Blessed be the God of our salvation, who bears our burdens and forgives our sins. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Have mercy upon us, Lord, have mercy upon us, Lord, have mercy upon us, Christ, have mercy upon us, Christ, have mercy upon us, Christ, have mercy upon us.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. On this fifth Sunday in the season of Lent, we pray. Almighty God, you alone can bring into order the unruly wills and affections of sinners. Grant your people grace to love what you command and desire what you promise, that among the swift and varied changes of the world, our hearts may surely there be fixed, where true joys are to be found. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of Holy Scripture.
A reading from the book of Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. The word of the Lord for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us say together Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your loving kindness. In your great compassion, blot out my offenses. Wash me through and through from my wickedness, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you only have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight. And so you are justified when you speak, and upright in your judgment. Indeed, I have been wicked from my birth, a sinner from my mother's womb. For behold, you look for truth deep within me, and will make me understand wisdom secretly. Purge me from my sin, and I shall be pure. Wash me, and I shall be clean indeed. Make me hear of joy and gladness, that the body you have broken may rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Give me the joy of your saving help again, and sustain me with your bountiful spirit. The second reading is from the book of Hebrews. Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, You are my son, today I have begotten you. As he says also in another place, You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Glory to you, O Christ. Now, among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew, and then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it and will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "The voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I feel like one of the Greeks today, one of those saying, "We wish to see Jesus." That is part of the reason we come together for worship on Sunday mornings. Collectively, we wish to see Jesus. Actually, we need to see Jesus. When our hearts and our minds are troubled, even when our souls are troubled, we need to see Jesus. We know Jesus identifies with our suffering and our burdens. We even hear today that the very soul of Jesus is troubled. And what does he do? He turns to God. He does not give up. He embraces and accepts what life has put in front of him. And sometimes life throws an awful lot our way. But God promises never to leave us or abandon us in the midst of life struggles. Jesus endures, he suffers, he dies unto himself that God might be glorified, that love might be born, that hearts might be changed, that true joys might be known. Therein lies our hope. We are in the last days of a long and unusually dark Lent with all that is going on within us and around us. As our opening collect says, among the swift and varied changes of the world. That is why we need to see Jesus. That is why we remind each other that we are together on this journey, together in our wish to see Jesus. We wish to see Jesus in the midst of a pandemic where loss, grief, isolation, fear, and illness have been wreaking havoc on our world for over a year now. We wish to see Jesus as we continue admitting and reckoning with racial injustices and racial discrimination in our communities and in our nation. We wish to see Jesus in the increasing polarization of our political system. We wish to see Jesus in our personal struggles, whether financial, physical, emotional or relational. We wish to see Jesus as the 12-year litigation that has torn our diocese apart comes to an end. We wish to see Jesus as many of us leave buildings where we have worshiped for years, celebrating baptisms, weddings, funerals, and weekly gatherings for Holy Eucharist. We wish to see Jesus in our daily lives, in our daily living. We wish to see Jesus as we imagine and move forward in new ways of following and serving Jesus. We have something in common with these Greeks that arrive on the scene in John's gospel. They approach a disciple and say, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." These Greeks, they were wanderers in search of truth, souls hungering for more, individuals seeking meaning. The arrival of the Greeks was a sign to Jesus. Now, every time I read this gospel, I remember a sign God gave to me one time. I had stopped at a McDonald's in Dallas when I worked as a hospice chaplain. I noticed a young teenager who appeared to be homeless. I felt nudged to ask if he needed help, but I decided to ignore that nudge and get on with the busyness of my day. I pulled out of the parking lot, turning right, and immediately ending up at a railroad crossing when the arms dropped to stop me in my tracks. Obviously, I got the sign from God and returned to offer help to this homeless teen. I wish God's signs were always that clear. No telling how many opportunities I have missed because there were not railroad crossing arms to stop me in my tracks. The Greeks were that kind of sign to Jesus. They were the sign that told Jesus the time had come for him to offer his greatest act of love. For God's message through Jesus had traveled. It traveled beyond the Hebrews to the Gentiles, beyond the Jews to the Greeks. This was the first step in the gospel being spread throughout the world. Now, Jesus gives himself for all people, not just the Jewish people. Jesus' love is for all nations, all races, all people. Jesus' love is for the poor and the rich, the old and the young, the free and the oppressed, the gay and the straight, the living and the dying. Jesus' love is for the least and for the great. Jesus gives himself for all to draw all to God. To draw all to God. Did you catch that language? Jesus does not drive us to God or force God on us, but invites us through his love into relationship with God. God's constant mission is to draw us to God's self. We hear this in Jeremiah. It is God's initiative to restore relationship. It is God who says, "I will make a new covenant. I will put my law within them. I will write it on their hearts. I will be their God. I will forgive their sins, and I will remember their sin no more." This is God's promise, the new covenant, that shows the extent of God's grace and patience with us and for us. We are God's people, people who live by the grace of the new covenant in Jesus Christ. God's grace is extended to us through Jesus. We might even find comfort in how Jesus models for us prayers with loud cries and tears, showing us that it is okay to cry out, to scream and holler even, to call God's attention to our circumstances, as if God isn't already aware. I've lost count of the number of people who have said to me about their anger, frustration, worries, and concerns, Oh, I could never say those things to God. But truly, God is as close as the very breath you breathe. God knows your burdens. God shares your tears. It is in praying with bold honesty that we relate more deeply with God. It is in praying with abandon that we connect more fully with God, with God who was clothed in the flesh of Jesus, to show us that sometimes suffering is not just something to be endured, but something to be embraced. That is not easy, but when we trust in the life-giving, redemptive grace of God to see us through our seasons of suffering, we are sure to find silver linings of God's love and mercy breaking through, helping us to see Jesus, even when our souls are troubled. As we enter these last 2 weeks of Lent, leading us to the foot of the cross, keep your sights set on seeing Jesus. Try not to be as blind as I was and need a railroad crossing sign to help you see Jesus. Take every opportunity to serve Christ and to follow Christ. For on the other side of all of this suffering is new life, indeed, resurrected life. Amen.
I invite you to stand as you're able and let us say together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people. God, we are in the wilderness. As much as we have tried to map, domesticate, and routinize every inch of your creation and every moment of our lives, we know our maps do not tell us where we are with you, and that our schedules often serve to distract us from the reality that we ourselves and so many of our neighbors on this planet are in the wilderness too. And so we pray, here in this wilderness, prepare your way, O God. With all persons kept in poverty or slavery, all who are in fear from abusers, terrorists, and oppressors, all who face addiction of any kind, and all who are targeted for unjust treatment because of who they are, we pray. Here in this wilderness, prepare your way, O God. With leaders in religious, political, economic, and social life, with our families, friends, and neighbors, and with all who work to sustain and protect our lives as military, civilian workers, and first responders, we pray. Here in this wilderness, prepare your way, O God. with all who need your healing power, and with all who offer healing through their skill and presence, we pray. Here in this wilderness, prepare your way, O God.
And I invite your own prayers at this time. Receive the prayers of your people, most merciful God, and remain with us in these wilderness times. Grant us comfort and courage to restore relationships among God's people and God's created earth. Amen.
Amen.
Let us also pray for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy among us, most merciful God. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Holy Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, in the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in life everlasting. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
The Spirit drove Jesus into the wilderness. The Spirit drives us there as well. Settle in. Make strange companions. Endure the trials. Trust the angels. Learn the way. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier be upon you and remain with you in whatever wilderness you find yourself. Amen. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.